The vision of oneness is there for me. The vision of oneness sets me free. The vision of oneness is there for me. The vision of oneness sets me free. The vision of oneness is there for me. The vision of oneness sets me free. The vision of oneness is mine to keep. The vision of oneness wakes me from sleep. The vision of oneness is mine to keep. The vision of oneness wakes me from sleep. Okay, these are the practices. Now, why are these practices important? What we're doing is we're owning. We're practicing ownage of the vision of oneness. It's ours. Because it is. It's our gift. It's the gift that God has given to us. We have to accept it. God has this gift for us, and our hands are closed. You know, we say, how can I accept that my hands are closed? God, open your hands. I mean, accept it and say, yeah, okay, this is mine. This is mine. It belongs to me. It does belong to us. Vision of oneness belongs to us. God doesn't need that. We need it because of the continuity problem. So, the vision of oneness is mine to see. The vision of oneness sets me free. There's another way. The vision of oneness is mine to see. The vision of oneness sets me free. The vision of oneness is there for me. The vision of oneness is mine to see. The vision of oneness sets me free. The vision of oneness is mine to keep. The vision of oneness wakes me from sleep. So that's like a five-phrase practice. The vision of oneness is there for me. The vision of oneness is mine to see. The vision of oneness sets me free. The vision of oneness is mine to keep. The vision of oneness wakes me from sleep. We have to take the next step, we have to focus on ownage. It's there. Vision of oneness is there, but we feel it doesn't belong to us. We feel like we've been peeking at it, and it doesn't really belong to us. We think, oh, wow, I was able to get a glimpse of it. And, wow, you're kind of like peeking at some mansion, you know, you look over the wall of a mansion, and you see this beautiful mansion there, and you think, wow, unbelievable. And then you run off, and you think, hi, I saw this mansion. We don't realize it belongs to us. it's our mansion. and that's the great good news. So we see the vision of oneness, and we say, I wonder who owns that? I wonder who that's for. Boy, they're fortunate. Incredibly fortunate to have that. That's just like the ultimate. Well, it belongs to us. That's all we're saying here. It belongs to us. The mansion does belong to us. And so we have to change our expectations. And just as we're changing the light on this video, sometimes you have to adjust it so that the vision of oneness is there for me. Okay, the vision of oneness sets me free. The vision of oneness is there to see. I see it. The vision of oneness is there for me. It's mine. The vision of oneness sets me free. Sets me free of my continuity concerns. The vision of oneness is mine to keep. I get to keep it. It's not like somebody is showing me their diamond, some kind of diamond. Say, look at this beautiful diamond. And you look at it and say, oh, great. Then you have to give it back. You know, they're showing their jewels to you or something. Or their car. Look at this car. Isn't that great? You want to sit in the seat? Oh, yeah, isn't that great? But then they drive off with it. Now, the vision of oneness is there for me. The vision of oneness is mine to see. The vision of oneness sets me free. The vision of oneness is mine to keep. The vision of oneness wakes me from my sleep. Gently wakes us up. So ownage is what we have to work on. Okay, that's all important. I'm seeing that. Anybody can catch a glimpse of it. Anyone can look at that mansion through the hedge. Maybe they look through oh, I see some mansion there. Oh, it's so nice. I see the lawn and the trees and the pool and everything. But we need to go up to the front door and walk in and realize this is our mansion. We own it. The vision of oneness is for us. We own it. It's ours. It's ours. It's what a gift that God has given to us to wake us up from this coma of forgetfulness. And so we do have to own it. The vision of oneness is there for me. It's mine. The vision of oneness is there to see. Okay. It's there for me to see. The vision of oneness sets me free. The vision of oneness is there for me. The vision of oneness is for me to see. The vision of oneness sets me free. The vision of oneness is mine to keep. The vision of oneness wakes me from sleep. We can say the vision of oneness is there to see. So first you're seeing it, and then you say the vision of oneness is there for me. Okay, it's another step. The vision of oneness sets me free. Vision of oneness is mine to keep. I get to keep it. It's not a lease. It's not a loan. We're not paying a lease on it. It's free. Okay. Maybe I should say the vision of oneness is free for me. It doesn't cost anything. The vision of oneness is there to see. The vision of oneness is there for me. The vision of oneness is totally free. The vision of oneness is mine to keep. The vision of oneness wakes me from sleep. This is the step that has to be taken. The only difference between us and some of these exalted saints and sages and avatars, saviors, gurus, etc. in the past is that they accepted that it is for them. They realized, oh, this is for me. It's free. It's there to see. It's there for me. It's there and it's free. It's mine to keep and it's there. It's for to wake me. Its purpose is to wake me from sleep. They just simply recognize this. So we have to have the same attitude, same recognition. We have to recognize it. And then we will certainly be abiding in the vision of oneness, just like anyone else who does it. So the vision of oneness is there to see. That's the first time I see it. Okay, it's there, I see it. Now the vision of oneness is there for me. Who's it there for? It's there for me. The vision of oneness is totally free. It doesn't cost me anything, all right? There's no cost associated with it, ever. Then you say the vision of oneness is mine to keep. I get to keep this. It's totally free and I get to keep it. Vision of oneness wakes me from sleep. What's its purpose? It's going to wake me up from this coma of forgetfulness. It's going to remind me of reality. So this is a very nice five-step practice. When what we're talking about now and the focus is marshaling your spiritual will to actually practice. Because if you don't, the world, the distractions and pressure of the world are going to drag you down into arguments, into confusion, into irrelevancies. Because for sure, you have to abide in the vision of oneness in order to be saved, in order to be reconciled back to reality. There's different terms that different religions use, reconciliation, salvation, all this stuff. It's really all the continuity problem is all it is. And the only way the continuity problem is truly resolved, totally resolved, is the vision of oneness. That melts it, the continuity fears, concerns, the continuity concerns we have, melts it away. And again, for those who ask, what are our continuity concerns? What's the continuity problem? It's basically, we have been in a state of such denial and forgetfulness of what reality is, trying to uncreate creation. We believed it was something that could be uncreated. So we have this totally wrong picture of reality. We're totally used to this, and we dread having that disappear, what we're used to disappear suddenly, and what we're totally unused to, suddenly we're experiencing that forever. You know, we just think it's going to shock us. The transition is too severe. We want a smooth continuity between what we're experiencing and something else. We want it to be smooth and soft and smooth, the transition. So we fear this abrupt transition from denial of reality to acceptance of reality. And so this is a problem, the one problem that God recognizes that we have is this continuity problem. And so God gave us this free gift called the Vision of Oneness to solve that continuity problem for us. That's all that all the great traditions, etc., that's all they're talking about, really. It's very simple. And so we have to accept this gift. Accept it. Don't throw it away. Don't say, oh, well, it's not mine. I'll give it. Who do I give it back to? Who do I give it back to? No, it's mine to keep. So the Vision of Oneness is there to see. We need to marshal our will to focus on this. Otherwise, the ego has a substitute for us that seems, you know, cotton candy for us. That seems kind of interesting, but that's only the superficial face of innocence of it, okay? The ego's very good at putting the smiley, superficial face of innocence upon what its plan. But you can see the superficiality of it. There's a difference between the sages who are abiding in oneness and bliss who are smiling, and those superficial egotists who are putting on the smiley face of innocence. There's a big difference. You can tell the difference. You can tell the difference. One has the true tranquility of being saved. The other has a sort of slyness behind it. You know that it you can tell it's a front. It's a front for something else. So we run the risk if we don't marshal our spiritual will and put it to use. How do you put spiritual will to use? Right spiritual practice. The Vision of Oneness is there to see. There to see. The Vision of Oneness is there for me. The Vision of Oneness is totally free. The Vision of Oneness is mine to keep. The Vision of Oneness wakes me from sleep. This is a very powerful practice you can use. The other one that I suggested last video was the Vision of Oneness is mine to keep. The past belongs to the Holy Spirit. It's also extremely powerful. Because you might wonder, well, all this attempt to undo creation, what do we do with it? Give it to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will take care of it, and the Holy Spirit knows how to let go of it all. Once we don't need it anymore, the Holy Spirit will effortlessly let it go. In the meantime, it'll hold it for us, just in case we might want it back. Holy Spirit, don't worry, I won't destroy anything. I'll just keep it safekeeping for you. I'll put it in storage for you until such a point where I don't need it anymore and don't feel any need to go back to it. So just give this whole attempt to uncreate creation, to claim that there was something prior to God, that God has a past where God was not God, but there was some kind of organic development, you know, some kind of evolutionary development that eventually developed God, developed truth, as if truth is something that is compounded out of all these compoundings that we're trying to. Showcase the past of reality, the past of creation, the past of God. What came before? What became before? Nothing came. None of that came before. So what do we do with this when we realize this is all much ado about nothing? It's completely useless. Completely useless. Give it to the Holy Spirit. So the past, meaning this whole effort we've been engaged with to try and uncreate creation, just hand it over to the Holy Spirit and say, it's yours. It belongs to you. It doesn't belong to me anymore. I'm giving it to you. And the Holy Spirit will gladly accept this from you. And then you're done with it. And then what do you have? The Vision of Oneness. That's what you exchange it for. Vision of Oneness. So there are lots of distractions happening now. I'm experiencing, there's all sorts of angles coming in of really stuff, negativity, trying to drag us down, trying to keep us from practicing. And we think, well, I better pay attention to that now and take care of it. No. First order of business is always right spiritual practice. That's the first order of all business in your life. The other stuff has to wait. See, I got it done, and now I get a call. See, that's how it works. All right, so get your exercise, get your marshaling of your will done first. That's the whole order of business in this world. You have to have your priorities straight. And it's all about valuing. What do we value? And the ego has got us all confused. Our attempt to uncreate creation has got us very confused. And we don't have to straighten out that confusion. The Vision of One, all we need to do is be reminded of reality. Because how can we straighten out the confusion if we have no idea what reality is like? What basis do we have to straighten anything out? That is our problem. We don't have a clue to what reality is really like. We really don't know. This experience we're having now is completely dissimilar. Radically dissimilar. So how can we say, well, okay, this is how we order this and this, and we'll fix this here, this will remind us. We don't know. How can we fashion something out of this world that reminds us of reality when we don't have a clue what reality is like? Well, we say, well, these superstars, these actresses and actors, or these celebrities, they must know. They live in a big mansion, they got a lot of money. They're my role models too. No, they're clueless. They're clueless. Well, you know, these great leaders, these great stateswomen, whatever. They must know because they're heads of state and everything. No, they don't have a clue. They don't have a clue. Only the Holy Spirit knows what reality is like, okay? And those who have abided in the vision of oneness, they've been reminded, so they know also. But without the vision of oneness, they wouldn't have known if they were those that needed to be reminded. There are those that come into this world who never forgot reality. Those are very unique conditions. But most of us, we've forgotten. So we need to be reminded. And the vision of oneness is what reminds us. And once we abide in that, we will definitely remember. It'll dawn upon us. Gradually it'll dawn upon us. Very smoothly, softly, gently, it'll dawn upon us. And we'll remember, this is reality. I had forgotten it. Now I'm remembering it. I've really forgotten it. So we have to confess, I've forgotten it, God. There's a confession of, I have a continuity problem. I can't remember. I really don't know. I don't have a clue. Really, I don't. And then we get clued in. We get clued in. God says, oh, okay, let me help clue you in. So then you value being clued in. And then you get clued in. It's just like that. If you don't admit you have a continuity problem, you won't value getting clued in. You'll say, what's that for? It's useless. I don't need it. I don't have any problem. Why are you bringing my attention there? It's a waste of my time. I don't want to deal with that. I'm focusing on these entertainment stars. They're the ones who have the answer for me, what I want. They're showing me, they're reminding me of something I really want. Fame, fortune, adulation, idolatry, all this kind of stuff. So it's a matter of what you value. If you value being clued in and say, I've really forgotten, I value being reminded, then the reminders will come for you. The reminders will come for you. You'll pay attention. You'll see it. You'll say, oh, good, that's what I'm looking for. It's kind of like you're on the road driving, and if somebody points out a particular car and says, you know what, I want you to find, I'll give you $1,000 if you find 20 of those cars today as you're driving. You know what? You're going to be looking, and you'll find that those cars, and suddenly you see them everywhere. Oh, I didn't, and you realize you never saw them before. You really never noticed them before. We used to call that the Volkswagen bug thing. We do that, and we think oh, like an orange bug. I wonder if we can see some orange Volkswagens when there are so many in the road. And suddenly, oh, there's one. You think, huh? How come I never saw those before? I didn't really pay attention. Its perception is very selective. It's very highly selective, our perception. So to be clued in properly, we have to value being clued in to being helped for what our problem really is. Our problem is we've forgotten what reality is like. We're afraid to waken up from our coma of forgetfulness. We need to be clued in and reminded. And the vision of oneness is this perfect reminder. It's just wonderful, 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 great good news for us. And it's just tremendous. And that, so we need to practice our valuing and expectations in that direction. We got to turn our valuing towards the vision of oneness. That is what the whole spiritual path is all about. Turn your valuing towards this vision of oneness. And once your valuing gets very strong and focused, then it will dawn upon you. Vision of oneness will dawn upon you, and you will abide in it because we've been practicing ownership of it. We own it. It's our gift. It's given to us. The vision of oneness is there to see. The vision of oneness is there for me. The vision of oneness is totally free. The vision of oneness is mine to keep. The vision of oneness wakes me from sleep. Use it. It's free. It's free. We want to convey. It's important to convey. It's totally free. The vision of oneness. Nobody owns it. The Holy Spirit owns it. Okay. okay? The Holy Spirit has given this to us free, saying, it's yours. I'm keeping it for you. I'm making sure it can't be lost. I'll always have it. But I'm totally sharing it with you as one, because the Holy Spirit actually is our spirit being blessed. So we own it. We own it. Because we include, our spirit includes the Holy Spirit. But we could say the Holy Spirit owns it, but it's free. It doesn't cost anything. No religion owns it. No person owns it. It's the Holy Spirit shares it with everyone. It's everyone is given the vision of oneness. It's there for everybody, free, forever. No charge, no obligation whatsoever. It simply is, our obligation is that we wake up from this dream of forgetfulness. That's inescapable obligation, because we can't change what we are. So we have to awaken. So we do have that one obligation, and this helps us fulfill that obligation. But there's no charge for the vision of oneness. Nobody has copyrighted, nobody owns it, nobody's trademarked it, nobody can prevent you from experiencing it. Nobody can charge you for experiencing it, saying, hey, I own that, you owe me some money for that. You know, that's totally bogus. Vision of oneness is there to see. The vision of oneness is there for me. The vision of oneness is totally free. The vision of oneness is mine to keep. The vision of oneness wakes me from sleep, the sleep of forgetfulness. So I have a little break in my work right now. So I'm using this time to tape. You see, this is an example. Say, oh, I have a little bit of time off. What do I do? Do I, you know, watch a movie, do I watch some TV, do I listen to some music, whatever. How about saying, you know what, I got to turn my valuing towards the vision of oneness. It's the only cure there is. It's the only way there is. You have to do that. Now, how people do that varies, is unique in each case. Exactly how they turn their valuing towards the vision of oneness varies among everybody a little bit here, and, you know, yeah, it's not exactly the same. So everybody will have a different, slightly different history in terms of their efforts. That's fine, doesn't matter. There's many ways to turn your valuing in that direction, but certainly you have to do it. One way or the other, you have to do it. And if you're delaying, it's going in the other direction. You're valuing something else. And it makes the continuity problem more difficult. So we're saying, let's turn our valuing towards the vision of oneness, and especially important, claim ownership of it. We have to claim ownership of it. It's ours. We can't give it away to someone else, say, it's not mine, it's yours. No, it is ours. It belongs to us. It belongs to us. It's been given to us. It belongs to us. So the vision of oneness is there to see. The vision of oneness is there for me. The vision of oneness is totally free. The vision of oneness is mine to keep. The vision of oneness wakes me from sleep. Hot off the press. This just occurred to me as I was, just before taping. I've been working this morning trying to come up with the right something to share as helpful. And finally this came into the format, and then it came into a clear format when I was doing the taping. And it's a good one. The vision of oneness is there to see. First step, the vision of oneness is there for me. Second step, the vision of oneness is totally free. Third step, relief, okay. The vision of oneness is mine to keep. Fourth step, and the vision of oneness wakes me from sleep. The fifth step. So kind of sequentially there, it develops stronger and stronger issues, addresses stronger and stronger, deeper and deeper issues. Because ultimately we do need to wake up from our coma of forgetfulness, right? And the vision of oneness does that. What a beautiful day today, and yet here we are focusing on the first order of business. It's like we're used to it here in California. It's ridiculous, really. I mean, there's a lot of times we just have to laugh and say, it's just ridiculous. How nice is, are you kidding me? Just unbelievably, sparklingly beautiful, balmy, clear day, and it's just like, Yeah, but where are my thoughts? It's on the practicing. The vision of oneness is there to see. The vision of oneness is there for me. The vision of oneness is totally free. The vision of oneness is mine to keep. The vision of oneness wakes me from sleep. So what is the spiritual path? The spiritual path is to turn our valuing towards the vision of oneness. And that's the only way we'll see it and recognize it and accept it. Otherwise, it'll have no value to us and we will not even see it. For one, well, if we turn our valuing away from it, we'll say, oh, it's not there to see. It's not there for me. It's not free. It's not mine to keep. And it doesn't have anything to do with sleep or waking me from sleep. That's our attitude. That'll be our attitude. And if you look at the world right now, that is the world's attitude. The attitude of the world is, there is no vision of oneness. What are you talking about? You're crazy. That's the first one, right? When I say the vision of oneness is there to see, the world will say, there's nothing there to see. They're just complete liars. They're crazy. They're, you know, mental case. There's nothing there. The second the vision of oneness is there for me, they'll say, there's nothing there for me. What are you talking about? I don't deserve anything like that. I don't see anything like that for me. It doesn't exist. What are you talking about? So the third, the vision of oneness is totally free. And they say, no, anything good costs a ton of money. It's impossible. It couldn't be free. No way. Someone's going to be charging. Someone's making money off it. You know, the world's that way. The vision of oneness is mine to keep. They say, no, anything valuable like that, I can't afford it. I can't keep it, you know. So that's ridiculous. Like, it's not possible. And the vision of oneness wakes me from sleep. They say, what are you talking about? I'm not sleeping. What sleep? What sleep are you talking about? So the world attitude is totally opposed to this spiritual practice. Totally opposed to it. Just saying you're nuts. On all accounts, you're nuts. That is the sleep you have to come out of. The sleep we have to come out of is the total stream of forgetfulness of reality and the devaluing of awakening. We say there's nothing to wake to. What are you talking about? This is real. This is reality. Sensory perception is reality. What are you talking about? The body is what I am. I'm the body mind. This is all there is. What are you talking about? That's the severe coma. That's a severe coma of forgetfulness. So, the vision of oneness is there to see. It is there to see. Vision of oneness is there for me. It is there for me. The vision of oneness is totally free. It is totally free. The vision of oneness is mine to keep. It is mine to keep. And the vision of oneness wakes me from sleep. That's what it does. It wakes me from sleep. That's its function. So, because the world is so antagonistic towards this, it's a problem. It's a problem for sure. And people are having a hard time marshaling their will to do this because they feel like, I can't really tell my friends and family I'm doing this because they'll think I'm nuts. You know, I don't tell, who knows I'm even doing this, maybe just even one person, but really I don't tell anybody in terms of the content of what I'm doing because they'll say, you're nuts, what are you talking about? So that's a strain, it is a strain. I found I had to do the path on my own because people said, you're wasting your time. That's when I did try to explain to them, they said, you're wasting your time. Why are you wasting your time? This is complete waste of time. There's no value to it. No value. Never be any value to it. That's what I always got. There'll never be any value to this. You're just totally spending your time in a idle fashion, really. And it's stupid. It's stupid. You don't have good sense. That's what you get. So, don't think that you need somebody else's approval to do these exercises. You can do them silently while you're wherever you are. The vision of oneness is there to see. The vision of oneness is there to see. It is there. I tell you 100%, I guarantee it. It is there. Okay, I can guarantee that, having had glimpses of it. The vision of oneness is for me. The vision of oneness is there for me. It is there for us. Okay? It's not there for someone else that other than me. It is there for me. For each one of us, it's there for us to see. And the vision of oneness is totally free. There's no charge for it. There's nobody demanding a ticket for it. Okay. The vision of oneness is mine to keep. Vision of oneness is mine to keep. supposed to keep it. I'm not supposed to throw it away once I see it. Okay, I saw it. Okay, I don't deserve that or whatever. No, I gotta keep it. It's mine to keep. I'm supposed to keep it. That's the whole purpose, is to keep it. How else can it function then as a gentle reminder? A gentle reminder needs some time to work, right? Yeah, if you're gonna dry some clothes, gentle cycle, it takes a while. It takes a while. It's not super hot, right? It's gentle cycle, mild cycle. So it takes a while. We need to abide in this. So it gently awakes us, reminds us of reality. And the vision of oneness, it awakes me from the sleep. It gently wakes me up from the sleep of forgetfulness. So the vision of oneness is there to see. The vision of oneness is there for me. The vision of oneness is totally free. The vision of oneness is mine to keep. The vision of oneness wakes me from sleep. Anybody can do that anywhere. Anybody on the face of this planet can do that, right? If they value it. And the problem is most don't value it. They see no value. They think this is that they've uncreated creation, that they're in a situation that was prior to creation, and they just somehow haven't quite finished it somehow, because they don't feel like they're the true prime creators, having created God now, having proven that they're the real creators of God. It just somehow hasn't quite happened yet. But if they just pay attention to some idolatrous superstar or celebrity, something, that one knows the way, you know, the pomp and circumstance, and they're so, you know, famous and wonderful, that if I just follow them, you know, they're obviously close to maybe they even got it, that they realize how grandiose they are, that they created God. They're the ones who actually created God. And they say, yeah, we can all realize that we've created God. We're the ones that created God in the first place. Yeah. And so they see value in that. But if you realize that we did not create God, God is the prime creator, was not created. Okay. It's the prime creator. And we were created by the prime creator, not the other way around. And so our efforts to supplant God are futile, completely futile, totally futile, just a total time idly spent. So then you'll change your valuing, and you'll say, wow, vision of oneness is what I want to see. But the old habits die hard. The old habits die hard of being distracted by these glamorous, you know, people. Or, you know, intellectuals, or whatever whatever you've been attracted to. Anything other than the vision of oneness is a misattraction. You have to be attracted to the vision of oneness. Even being attracted to a guru is a misdirection in some regards, okay? What the guru does, the good ones, direct you, your attention off of them onto your practice towards a vision of oneness. Okay. That is what should be done. There are different techniques that are used. Some people use techniques of visualization of the guru or something that to help their powers of concentration and compounding and everything. But I would say, to be on the safe side, simply put your attraction onto the vision of oneness, and not on any person, not on any guru, not on any celebrity, not on any personality, not on any body, okay? Put it on the practice. Now, of course, there may be those who help you with the practice and they have seem to have a body and whatever, but you just accept them as someone who's an encourager. Someone's giving encouragement is all. But again, your attention is on the vision of oneness, which is not the same thing as putting your attention on a body or a personality. It is not. It's hard to describe. You have to experience it. What's important is to focus on ownership of it, that it's yours. It's yours. Okay. And what you see in the vision of oneness is that there's only one identity. So what you have, everybody has. There's only one identity. And what they have, you have too. But you do have to own the vision of oneness. You do have to abide in it. You have to say, this is mine. My mind has to be on this. It's for me. It's mine because God gave it to me. And what God has given to me, we cannot turn aside. We must accept it, that it is ours. So, the vision of oneness is there to see. The vision of oneness is there for me. The vision of oneness is totally free. The vision of oneness is mine to keep. The vision of oneness wakes me from sleep. Wakes me from my sleep. Wakes me from sleep. Wakes me from my sleep. Now, an encourager is valuable in that they're helping. There's some value there. But again, the value is minuscule compared to the value of vision of oneness. So it's pragmatically, there is some differentiation between one who's a coaching and encouraging, and in helping bring the will. It temporarily has a stronger, more unified spiritual will, temporarily. That has pragmatic value. But, so that's recognized, realized, but the focus is not on the attention of focus is only there for the purpose of focusing on spiritual practice. That's the whole point of it. You know, some people say, oh, guru, savior, sage, so you're so wonderful. You're so wonderful. Let me touch your feet. Let me bow to you. You're so wonderful. And oh, you're so beautiful. You're so beautiful. You're so wonderful. Oh, I just think you're so wonderful. And that's all they ever do. They don't actually start practicing. What they're really saying is, isn't there some way that I don't have to practice? I mean, I'm so busy, like, with other stuff. I mean, can you give me an exemption? Can you grant me an exemption? You know those students who try to butter up the teacher for an exemption or an A? I can't pass the test. I can't do all the work. I don't want to. But can you give me a good grade anyway? Because I've got a lot of cute antics and stuff or whatever, you know. So that's a waste of time. That's a waste of time. The guru is not awesome. The vision of oneness doesn't make you awesome. The vision of oneness is totally welcome, great good news. It is the gospel. It is the good news, for sure. But you realize everybody is totally sacred. Everybody is totally blessed. It's just that you're aware of it and others aren't. Others are trying to unmake this fact, you know, uncreate this, the facts of reality. So they don't value what is there to see. They don't value it. So there's just a temporary difference in status taking place there, a temporary difference in will and in calm and peace and all this stuff. It's temporary difference. Fine. That is to be respected. It has to be respected for sure, but only for the purpose of turning your attention to your spiritual, right spiritual practice, which is valuing the vision of oneness. That's the only reason that respect is there. And if the teacher takes you off in some other direction, then forget it. Don't value it anymore. Don't value it anymore. Because the value is on the vision of oneness, not on the teacher. Teacher gets value because they're helping you focus on the vision of oneness. But if they're trying to get you to focus on something else, no value there for you. No value. Say, there's no value in this. So I'm going to keep my focus on the vision of oneness. The vision of oneness is there to see. The vision of oneness is there for me. The vision of oneness is totally free. The vision of oneness is mine to keep. The vision of oneness wakes me from sleep. The past belongs to the Holy Spirit entirely. It's not my concern at all. All the stuff I did to try to uncreate creation, it's no longer my concern because it's all really nothing, much ado about nothing, but it is much ado. So if we keep thinking that we got to sort it out, we'll never get there. We don't have to sort anything out about nothing. It's all futility. What do we need to sort out about futility? But at least we think there's so much stuff there. We think maybe someday I might want to sort it out. So we give it to the Holy Spirit. Here, it belongs to you. And the Holy Spirit says, I'll keep it in safekeeping for you as long as you feel that you want me to. No problem. And eventually we say, hey, About nothingness. What do we need to sort out? Nothing, of course. There's much ado about nothing. So, the past, all this efforts, everything that, you know, we tried to do and we're still trying to do. Holy Spirit, it belongs to you now. I'm not involved with it at all. You can go archive it for me, do what you want to do. It doesn't matter. I know you'll keep it for me. You won't try to destroy anything. But just, it's gone. It's not mine. It's not mine anymore. Vision of Oneness is now mine. That is mine to keep. Sounds simple? It is simple. Don't think it's not simple. It sounds doable? It is doable. Don't think it's not doable. You just do it, is all. That's all there is. You just literally just do it. The ego keeps, you keep thinking, well, there must be something first that I do. That comes from our desire, that comes from our whim to that we're insisting there's something before God, prior to God. So when we say these practices are easy, you say, yeah, I can see it, but what comes before that? You know, I don't have that part yet. There is no that part yet. Just like there is no that part yet prior to God, there is no that part yet prior to right spiritual practice. But we get hung up on that. We get hung up on it. Of course. Because this whole thing is belief that there's something prior to God that we're involved in, that we actually compounded God, or that God's actually some compound that we made. And so prior to God, we think there's something. So prior to right spiritual practice, which is orients us towards God, we think, okay, well, what comes before that? Let's first figure out what came before it. Always. That's what trips people up. You can see it, easily see it in everybody. They say, okay. That sounds like good practice. Okay. But I'm just, okay. Have you been practicing? No, I'm working on what, you know, the step before this. And what is the step before this? There is no step before it. You just say it. The vision of oneness is there to see. The vision of oneness is there for me. The vision of oneness is totally free. The vision of oneness is mine to keep. The vision of oneness wakes me from sleep. You just say it. You just focus on it. That's all. There is no before it. That's like we're breathing. We say, wait, I gotta stop breathing. I can't breathe yet. Let's say someone's holding their breath and they're turning blue in the face, and you say, come on, what's the matter? Breathe. They say, no, why? I can't. I'm trying to figure out what comes before breath. All right. I can't. We're like that. We're not breathing. I'm trying to figure out what is it that, what made breath? What comes before breath? I can't breathe until I figure that out. So. The vision of oneness is there to see. The vision of oneness is there for me. The vision of oneness is totally free. The vision of oneness is mine to keep. The vision of oneness wakes me from sleep. Got it. Nothing we need to do before that. We need to actually just say it. Of course, the mood of continuity, the mood of repentance is the basis of focusing in on this. Okay. But as far as actually saying it, there is no first part. Saying it is the first part. Just trust me on that. You got to, otherwise you're never gonna do it. Never gonna do it if you keep thinking, no, what came before that? Wait a minute, what came before that? Now, that's our habit. Because we're saying, what came before God? We're trying to figure out what came before God. We think we made God, we think. We made God, so we just can't remember how we did it, you know. We're trying to remember, how do we make God, you know? It's a secret, we think. God's keeping a secret from us. No, there is no secret. There is no secret. We didn't make God. All right? Okay. Keep at it. Very important right now. Super important. Marshal your will. All right. Very great. That's it.